history, Alex combines the rigorous standards for research and analysis set by academics with the use of popular writing, historic sites, public monuments, and innovative presentations to share Boston's history. Alex believes that American history can be more clearly understood by studying the nearly 400-year-old capital of Massachusetts. He has been creating and leading tours of Boston's historic neighborhoods since 2000. We in the North End are very lucky that Alex had his home until very recently here with his family. And I do hope, we all hope, that he's going to continue to have a very strong presence in this neighborhood. There were attempts in the past, many years ago, to create some form of a historical society in this oldest neighborhood of Boston. And they did not succeed, but Alex seems to have succeeded and generated much interest by the people who live here, as well as others, in the history of our neighborhood. I'm so happy to have him here tonight. Alex.
It's so dark I can no longer see the clock that usually reminds the minister when the time's almost up. So for your sake, I'll put my phone up here. And I wanted to thank David and Anne and the Residents Association for involving the Historical Society and me in particular in this project. So I'm very happy to be here. I've been here before as a Stephen. All right, that'll be the last time. One more time. How's that? You know, it's so dark if you sneak out because of that, I won't notice that either, but 10 years ago, when I lived on Salem Street, I've spent 11 years living within a stone's throw of this church. And 10 years ago when I lived on Salem Street, I came wandering in here, and I asked to speak to the minister, who then as now is Reverend Stephen Ayers, and I said, I need to speak to the minister. And so I was received right away, probably thinking there was some emotional or life-threatening concern that I had that required pastoral care. So we sat down in Stephen's office, and he asked me what was my trouble. And I said, well, I live so close to the church, and I know so much about it, and I just really want a place to tell people what I know. And although not certainly a life-threatening concern, Stephen took me back out of his office and introduced me to the folks who run the museum side of this operation, and they put me to work right here at this lectern. So I did spend some time up here before, and I'm very happy to be back. And very happy also for the support that Old North and Stephen in particular have given to the Historical Society and to the production of our journal, which features this venerable building on its cover, and of course, is available here tonight. And also pleased to see so many members of the society out there, so thanks once again. The book on the left, by the way, is My History of the North End, which had its book launch here 3 years ago, so I'm happy to keep returning again and again. As David and Anne know, I was an abettor of the Prado for 9 years. And I don't know if any of you could hear while Rebecca was speaking. I was paying attention. But through the open window, could you hear the opera singing? Yes, yes. That's Wesley Thomas, I believe is his name. My daughter and I call him Opera Guy. And he's one of the, he lives in the North End, but he's one of the many people who do not cater to the local clientele, let's say. And although he's there to get money for tourists. And although it's very romantic to hear these operatic strains come through the window while we're sitting here tonight, I assure you, as an abettor, it is not romantic at all. And I'm looking forward to the day that the Prado is returned to, as David put it, its former uses, primarily in a neighborhood park. Okay. Enough complaining. So, what is remembered in the Prado? And that's my assignment for tonight. And this terrible picture is part of the plaque that was installed to orient you when you're in the Prado. And at the very bottom, you see it's telling us that it is dedicated to the enjoyment of the community and to the memory of those men and women who made Boston the pride of later generations. Not just the people from the North End who did that, but they made not just the North End the pride of later generations, but the people of Boston. And as we saw earlier, there are some plaques that are missing. Several plaques that had to do with different aspects of the Bill of Rights, especially the First Amendment. And to answer your question, if I had to guess, I'd guess that if those plaques still exist, they would be lying in the basement of the City Archaeology Lab, which until recently was in the neighborhood. There were many other plaques and tombstones and weather vanes lying in the hallways in that lab. So, first of all, we're talking about the founders of Massachusetts Bay. These are some of the people who are remembered in the Prado, all with some North End connection. Up in the corner,
here we go,
John Winthrop, the founder of Boston, and in many ways the founder of the experiment here in Massachusetts Bay. I'm sure you're all familiar with Governor Winthrop. He never lived in the North End. His house was not in the North End. His church was not in the North End. But he's listed out there in part because when he arrived in Massachusetts and originally thought the capital would be at the older settlement of Charlestown, eventually they moved across the river to Boston. And history, what we have in the history tells us that they entered at roughly at Prince Street. So he was one of the first people from Europe to come into Boston, and like many people after him, he came in through the North End. And directly below him is another woman mentioned out in the Prado. That's Annie Pollard. Ms. Pollard claimed to be with Winthrop's fleet. She was. She also claimed to be the first person to come ashore at Prince Street in 1630. That part, she lived to be over 100 years old, and so no one could remember if she was telling the truth or not. But that's her story, the first white woman to come into Boston, and again, it was through the North End. And via her recollections as an elderly woman, she tells us a little about the terrain of the Boston Peninsula, noting that it did not have many trees, but was uneven and filled with various bushes and shrubs and things of that nature. On the other side of the frame, two people I'm sure you've heard of, Increase and Cotton Mather, who held sway for some combined 70 or 80 years at the original Old North Church in North Square, which was founded in 1649. And under their leadership, well, we could talk about the Mathers all day, I'm sure that would please many people, but they were prolific clergymen, they were prolific writers, and they were, despite their position in the church, they were very political as well. And in fact, Increase Mather was born in Dorchester, but came to live in North End upon his ordination in the church in the 1660s. His son Cotton was born and raised here and lived here his whole life. After the fire that destroyed North Square in 1676, they moved to Hanover Street, where they lived the rest of their lives. Increase Mather, interestingly, when the king revoked Archer's charter in the 1680s, and Massachusetts had to send one person, or they decided to send one person to the court in England to lobby king and parliament for the return of a charter, upon which for over 50 years, all of our rights and all of our rights to property have been based. Pretty important task. And they sent Increase Mather, who spent 4 years in England lobbying for the return of the charter. In the meantime, his son was presiding over the concomitant social upheaval that comes with the basis of your entire society being ripped away. And of course, one of the results were the famous witch trials Neither member was a judge or directly involved, but they both published their opinions. Both, of course, believing, very, very much believing in angels and devils that walked among us. And Increase came out and said he would rather let one witch slip by than kill an innocent man. His son, on the other hand, said that it behooved every servant of the Lord to track down every possibility, and perhaps a few innocents might die, but it was worth it for the cause. Again, we can go on about these two, but the man in the middle was a close friend of theirs by the name of William Phipps. Sir William Phipps was the first governor appointed by the crown under our new royal charter in 1692, a poor man from Maine, which had been added to Massachusetts under the new charter. He, through the course of his life and adventures, discovered some Spanish treasure and made the appropriate tribute to the authorities in England, and was so knighted for his efforts. So he was appointed governor and built himself a grand estate at the corner of Salem and Chatter Street, adjacent catty corner from the church. And I believe that Charter Street takes its name from the fact that his estate was on Charter Street, and he was the first governor under that document. I wrote my master's thesis on the streets of the North End, so I have a lot of opinions. But, you know, these people are among the founders of our Commonwealth, and in some ways, the founders of the nation itself. So they're very, very important for people to know when they come to visit the North End. In fact, a very recent and good biography of John Winthrop, the subtitle is America's Forgotten Founding Father. Oh, this is Increase Mather's house as it looked at the turn of the 20th century. That is roughly where the ice cream is in the White Hen Pantry now on Hanover Street. The building survived until about 1906. And again, Increase moved in 1677. The building next to it, that's still there. That's where the cantina is. We're very familiar with this statue. This also tells us, you know, the Prado is not about only the founding of Massachusetts, but the founding of the country. So, of course, the people who were dominant in the world, you know, played dominant roles in the Revolution are remembered, including our friends Paul Revere and William Dawes. As you know, Paul Revere was born and raised here in the North End. His exact birthplace is still unknown, which is interesting for such a famous man who lived to be nearly 84, but we still don't know for sure. And William Dawes, of course, is also mentioned not just because of his role in the beginnings of the Revolution, but also because he lived at North Street. I think there is a little plaque that mentions that. He lives on that part of North Street across from Faneuil Hall. So again, these are people with North End connections who are mentioned. Some other founders of the country you might recognize, John Hancock and Ben Franklin. When David showed you that original plan for the Prado, which included the little park behind the church, the buildings on that site, there had been buildings owned by the Franklin family, by Ben himself, who was originally from Boston and grew up on the part of Hanover Street that is now adjacent to Government Center. Something that people forget about, and perhaps Franklin wanted to forget about it too when he left. John Hancock, let's not forget, is one of the wealthiest men in all the colonies. And before we had the office of President of the United States, he was President of the Congress, our highest administrative position. So not an obscure man. And among his many property holdings was a wharf, Hancock's Wharf, not far from where Lewis Wharf is today in the North End. And one of his ships, the Liberty, was famously seized by customs officials in 1768. So he also had this connection to the North End as it played into his patriotic activities and his persona as a supporter and benefactor of the anti-British activities. John Hancock, by the way, got out of that little snag. His ship was seized because they said he did not pay the proper taxes on the cargo in the ship. But the Sons of Liberty, very active by 1768, publicly marched themselves down to the wharf and scared away any officials who might interfere. Some other folks you may know, if we have any Harvard grads out there today, the man on the left is Edward Holyoake. And now until I visited the Prado, I did not know that Edward Holyoake was born in the North End. He had the second longest tenure as president of Harvard College, some 32 years. And during the time he was president, which encompassed the centennial of the university, he professionalized it, he modernized it. One of the innovations he brought was, instead of having one instructor who went with each class and taught each subject until that class graduated, he said, well, instructors should be specialists in their topic and teach the students just their topic. So perhaps it was pretty far-looking in the 1730s. And some of the students that graduated from Harvard under his tenure were John Hancock, Sam Adams, John Adams, James Otis, etc. and so forth. And he, in no small part, encouraged the Enlightenment ideals that all these men absorbed. And again, I, for all of my wandering and reading and talking about the North End, did not know he was from here. Next to him, of course, is one of his famous pupils, Sam Adams. And Governor Adams was a frequent visitor to the North End. He was from the South End, our old South End, but a frequent visitor to the North End and an active member of the political groups here, including the North End Caucus, a group that helped to plan the Boston Tea Party, in two North End taverns, the Green Dragon and the Salutation. Moving on from defenders of the country to defenders of the country. Of course, soldiers and officers in every war are commemorated out behind this church. From the Revolution, the War of 1812, the Civil War, the Spanish-American War, and the 20th century World Wars. And the man on the left is one of those people who was a major figure until he succumbed to wounds suffered at Malvern Hill in Virginia in 1862, 150 years ago this summer. That's Colonel Thomas Cass, commander of the famous Irish Ninth, the 9th Massachusetts. And Cass didn't live in the North End his whole life. He was born in Ireland. He lived some time at Chelsea, but by the time of the Civil War, when he was incidentally a member of the Boston School Committee, he lived on North Bennett Street. And after he was wounded in battle, after many battles, in 1862 he was brought back to North Bennett Street where he passed. And of course there is a statue of Colonel Cass in the public garden today. I have to believe that he used his role on the Boston School Committee prior to the Civil War to help ameliorate and improve the conditions for Irish Catholic students in our public schools, including the Elliot. Another man you may know on the right, Edward Everett, president of Harvard College, congressman, governor of Massachusetts, etc. and so forth. Born in Dorchester, like Increase Mather, but spent much of his childhood here in the North End and attended the Elliot School. Edward Everett was the featured orator at Gettysburg in 1863. He was to be the main event. He spoke for 2 hours, as he was asked to, talking about the meaning of the war, the history of the nation, and the cause of union. And he was followed by President Lincoln, who spoke very briefly, but it was, of course, Lincoln who we remember. And that was November 19th. The following day, the two men exchanged letters. which Everett said, I should be glad if I could find myself that I came as near to the point in 2 hours as you did in 2 minutes. Recognizing already the greatness of the president's speech, and the president graciously wrote back and said, well, I could not have been excused to make a long address any more than you could have been excused to make a short one. So in other words, we played our roles. But very interesting to see that there, everything has a North End connection in my mind, but this was real. And of course, the landmarks and the interesting people and events from the North End are commemorated out back in the Prado, and this map is in part reproduced. The famous original, oldest known map of Boston, made by John Bonner, and published originally in 1722. And you can see here the old neck, the only landmark into the town, making the North End the best way to enter Boston, by ferry, by ship. The darker parts on the map incidentally represent density. You can see Boston, after nearly a century of settlement, is densest near Boston Harbor, and most especially between Long Wharf and North Square. Also notice, in the back of the North End, well, in the back of Boston, is Beacon Hill, the West End, and Boston Common. Not nearly the central locations that they became. Looking more closely at the North End, you can see that the dark parts start to fade away as you head back in the direction of this church, which had now been built in 1722. And that is because this is the steeper part of the neighborhood and farthest from North Square and the harbor, and therefore the least desirable for people with any choice. Anyone who was anyone tried to live near North Square in colonial Boston. You can also see the burying ground, the lack of streets, the water mills, the windmills, the busy ferries, the Baptist church, and just a year later, an Anglican church, all in the back of the North End, because these were considered somewhat undesirable things to live next to. No offense. And on the other side of the Prado is St. Stephen's. And the etching on the left is from the 1840s, when the building was about 37 years old. There had been a congregation, a church, on that site since the year 1714. So it's an active church site, almost 300 years. And it was originally called New North, to differentiate it from its parent church in North Square, the Church of the Nativities, Old North. It would be some time before this church, Crest Church, received the nickname Old North. Of course, today this is now the oldest church building left in Boston. But if you look at St. Stephen's today, it became St. Stephen's during the Civil War. It looks very similar to that etching. But if you look at St. Stephen's the way people who grew up in the North End remember it, it's a little different. The decorative, are the urns that were on top of the church are missing? I'll go back. A clock has been added to the cupola, which is no longer there. But once we had, after the Civil War, the need to keep the trains on time, make everyone on the same timetable, the tall buildings in the cities, which are usually the churches, receive clocks. Also notice that the entranceway, the pilasters on the front of the building, these things no longer touch the sidewalk. And the original basement windows are boarded up, or bricked up, to make way for new ones. Again, look at it today. That's because Hanover Street was widened in 1870. And any building that could not be moved or partially destroyed would be completely destroyed. There's a long history of moving buildings in New England, and St. Stephen's was lifted up and moved back. And since it needed to be placed on a new foundation anyway, the very, very densely populated Irish Catholic neighborhood and the Irish Catholic hierarchy decided to have a basement church put underneath St. Stephen's. And it remained in this condition until 1964, when the Cardinal decided to restore it to its original appearance, removing the basement church and removing most ornamentation from the interior of the church to its original bullfinch design. So by the time, by 1965, when it reopened in its present condition, it's known then as it is now as the last remaining church designed by Charles Bullfinch in the city of Boston. Which is remarkable, because he was head of the town for 20 years and designed just about everything, and everything he didn't design was attributed to him anyway. But he really did design this one. His churches in other towns survive, but this is the only one left in Boston. You hear that?
Yes.
8:35. Okay. So on the left is not John Cusack. This is what it reminds me of. It's actually John Elliott, minister at the New North Church when this building, the current building, was built. And of course, he's the person our only remaining public school is named for. Next to him, the rather grim-looking fellow, is a Boston North End school teacher named John Tileston. And as David pointed out, the Elliott School's origins began in the winter of 1700. I know on their uniforms it says 1713. It's a mistake. I'll tell you why. But the school received its name in 1813. That's the year that Elliott died. So you might wonder, why was the school not named for John Tileston, who, after all, worked there for almost 80 years, 1749 to 1819. Oh, wait, that is 80 years. Is it? Or is it 70? It's a lot of years. That's what I'm saying. And he was master of the school for 60 years. And John Elliott had been one of his students. But so long-lived was Master Tileston that he outlived Elliott. So the school was named for the prominent minister, who was also one of the founders of the Massachusetts Historical Society, a man obviously interested in history himself. So in 1821, the city decided to honor Tileston after his retirement. They couldn't name his school for him, so they renamed the street. And it was one of the only instances in the history of Boston when a street was named after someone who was still alive. Technically, that's against the rules. And Tileston lived another 5 years. So the original name, by the way, for Tileston Street was Love Lane. But that, like most of the streets, like Candy Place, was named after the people whose land the street was cut through. So John and Susanna Love owned that property, just as Susanna Love's grandfather, Richard Bennett, owned a neighboring estate. Here is the Elliott School as it appeared in the antebellum era and in the lower quarter as it appeared from the Civil War until it was moved to Charter Street. This is 1865, I believe, is this picture. Relatively new building, prominent building befitting its stature, as today the Elliott School is the third oldest public school in the Boston system after Boston Latin and the Mather School of Dorchester. You can see everyone out here for the picture, and this area here would be redeveloped, and there's the old Ware School there, which was torn down to make way for the Columbus School. Obviously, this building spans the what is now a parking lot from Bennett Street to Tileston Street. But from its beginnings until the beginning of the Great Depression, the school had always been on either Tileston or North Bennett on that plot of land. And I believe the confusion over the name comes from this guy throwing out the first ball at the old Huntington Avenue grounds, now covered by Northeastern University, in 1910. This is Boston's first elected Irish-American mayor, John F. Fitzgerald. Born and raised in the North End, graduate of the Elliott School, and in 1913 was still mayor of Boston. And in that year, there was a big centennial banquet for the Elliott School, and he attended, many graduates did. And I think because the school had been named in 1813, and because its Latin school program had been begun in 1713, that by 1913, they had wrongly assumed that the school had been founded in that year, 1713. I'm hoping the school wasn't planning a big celebration next year for its 300th that I've possibly ruined, but I'm going to go ahead and blame Honey Fitz. Just a few other interesting characters who are mentioned out back. This is Dr. Harriet Keziah Hunt, first woman to apply to the Harvard Medical School in 1850. She applied three times and was denied all three times. So she went and apprenticed in medicine in Boston, learned the craft, and was given an honorary MD from the Medical College at Philadelphia, so she could honestly call herself doctor. And in 1856, she wrote this book, Glances and Glimpses, which tells us about her life, and in the process tells us about the North End as it was in the first half of the 19th century. She grew up basically where the Coast Guard base is now, roughly. She grew up on what is now Commercial Street near Hanover, and tells us about the wonderful homes and the comfortable living and the seaside breezes of her youth. By the way, a woman becoming a doctor before the Civil War anywhere in the country is a big deal. Maybe that's the end. Of course, I have been on a tour at the USS Constitution many times across the river in Charlestown, and they always mentioned that the ship was built in Boston. They never say the North End, even though you can see it when you're on board. But as many of you probably know, the Constitution was one of six frigates ordered by the U.S. Navy for the new U.S. Navy under President Washington in 1794. Five of the six frigates, they spread the contracts around several different states. This is Massachusetts, obviously. And five of the six ships received federal style names. After all, this is a new U.S. Constitution, and Washington and Adams were, of course, the center of the Federalist Party. So Constitution was built along with Constellation and the President and the United States and the Congress. The sixth ship was named a little bit later. Having been built in Virginia, it was named the Chesapeake. Didn't really fit in with the other five. And obviously, Constitution is the only one left, having been launched in October of 1797 from Hart's Shipyard at the foot of Hanover Street, the oldest surviving vessel afloat in the world today. You see her here without sails in the inner harbor. You'll see tugboats all around. She normally doesn't sail under her own power, but this year, the anniversary, the bicentennial of the War of 1812, where she got her nickname, Old Ironsides, although she's made of wood, the enemy cannonballs seem to be bouncing off her hull as if it were made of iron. She'll sail again under her own power this year. Here she is in the 1930s, making a visit to New York Harbor. You can see Lady Liberty in the corner. I like to remind people of constitutions from the North End. And of course, the landmark that's hosting us tonight, Christ Church, Old North. The founding rector of this church, Dr. Timothy Cutler, formerly the head of Yale College, another nice congregational school down in Connecticut. Dr. Cutler, by the way, is entombed roughly below where I'm standing right now. I hope he doesn't mind. And there's a view of his church in the late 19th century. You can see it also kind of received a clock after the Civil War. This building, the cornerstone, was laid in April of 1723, and the dedication service was held on December 29th of the same year. Craftsmanship. The steeple had not yet been erected in 1723. But the church itself, though, is, as it always has been, and it's today the oldest surviving church building in the city. The steeple you see in this photo is the second and longest running steeple on top of the church, the one that Paul Revere's friends used for those famous lanterns in 1775 was blown down in a hurricane during Revere's lifetime in 1804. And it was rebuilt, as you see here, about 15, 17 feet shorter than the original. It was attributed in many history books to Charles Goldfeld. I really don't think that's true, but it is possible. And this steeple was on top of the church for 150 years. And then, unfortunately, it was felled in another hurricane, Hurricane Carol, on the last day of August in 1954. Now, if you look closely at the clock, keep that image in your head. There it goes. I have a love-hate relationship with this photo. It's the only one, to a man from New York City visiting Boston. And of course, the steeple had been blowing back and forth in the hurricane all morning. So he was ready to capture the shot when it finally snapped, just before noon on August 31st. Of course, the wooden steeple was completely destroyed, and the ancient brick tower was ripped open. Here it is the next morning. The police had been evacuating people, told people to move their cars, just as today. Some people didn't listen. There's a little piece of mortar missing from the building across the street. The tour guides love to tell people that building there, it's missing that mortar because the steeple fell on it in 1954. I don't know. Who could know that? For those of you who live here, grew up here, you might recognize the young man in the shiny jacket. It's 15-year-old Johnny Shoes. And Johnny will tell you the story if you go down to Hanover Street. Obviously, though, the church was rebuilt. They went about raising $150,000 in 1950s money to rebuild the steeple. Within 10 months, the money had been raised. And just as today, a descendant of Paul Revere was involved, a young man named Paul Revere. The vicar of the church and other volunteers went around, went to New York. They sent the weather vane around the country in a display case. They asked school children and soldiers overseas for donations. They eventually got a couple in Connecticut to donate 200-year-old trees for the wood to rebuild the steeple. And the steel and other metal parts reinforcing it today were donated by the descendant company of the Revere Copper Company. So, about one year after the hurricane, the steeple was back. And that's the one we have upstairs today. I mentioned there are some deceased individuals below where you're sitting now. This is actually below the entrance to the church. There are over 1,000 people entombed below their former house of worship. In only 39 tombs, the church recently commissioned some research into this room. Some of it is published in our journal. This is a picture from the journal. And the way they were able to fit so many people downstairs is that figure now, the church opened in 23. They started entombing people in 1732. 100 years later, how many people were around that still remember who was down there, who was still related, who still came to visit their ancestors from a century ago? So they started breaking open the tombs, taking the ashes and putting them in small shoebox-sized boxes, leaving them inside the tombs for which they had paid. And they took the bones, and until the 1990s, they didn't know what happened to the bones. But the ashes, at least, were where they were supposed to be. And then they resold the tomb to new people. So even Reverend Dr. Cutler's tomb below my feet has another meaning scratched over his. Because even his tomb was resold in time, a practice that continued here until 1860, and the church's own records tell the story. Here's one of the tombs that remains open, just to give you a little glimpse of their scale and size. And those coffin boards have a name on them. Thomas Tullis. I don't know where he is. But in the 1990s, they were building a columbarium below the church, a place for the cremated remains of worshipers. And the workers on the site uncovered a human bone below the floor. So they stopped and looked into it and found that there is what is called a charnel pit downstairs. A very unusual thing to find in America. It's basically a big hole in the floor filled with bones. So all the bones are still below the church, oddly enough, and they were left undisturbed. Construction was diverted. Weird. And lastly, I just wanted to ask, who is not remembered in the Prado? Obviously, there are many folks of Italian, Irish, Jewish, Portuguese descent who, from the North End, did great things but are not remembered. Just a few, mostly soldiers, like Colonel Cass. But from the colonial era, most people living in the North End were Anglo or African. And so the black population of the North End is not mentioned in the Prado. I'm not making any particular commentary on that. I don't think it's unusual in the 1930s to skip over this population. But the oldest black community in Boston was based not far from the doors of this church, starting in the mid-1600s. On the right is a poster I got from the Library of Congress, which was made by Cotton Mather in 1693. For a group of black North Enders who approached him and asked him for his permission, his guidance in setting up a black church in the North End. The oldest known black church group in Boston. And they couldn't get a charter, they couldn't formally organize, they didn't build a building. But he let them use Old North, the original Old North and North Square, for the rest of his life. 35 years. So this is another aspect of the North End history that needs more research, but also is something that you won't find in the Prado, maybe in the future. On the left-hand side, in the year 1908, you see a group of Prince Hall Masons returning to Copse Hill Burying Ground, where the Prince Hall Monument was erected in 1895. There it is covered in ribbon and ivy. And as those of you who live here know, the Masons and other African-American groups return here every Memorial Day, coming up, 10 a.m. to the gravesite at Prince Hall before they move out into other areas of Boston and the suburbs on their Memorial Day commemorations. So it is still recognized by the black community of Greater Boston that the North End is an integral part of their history. And one other person from the colonial period who is not remembered in the Prado is Thomas Hutchinson, the only man I've yet found born and raised in this neighborhood to become governor of Massachusetts. And yet, when he left for England in 1774, he was perhaps the most hated man in America. Not a good record for our neighborhood. But prior to becoming Sam Adams' number one enemy, prior to becoming a victim of propaganda, some of it, I'm not saying it was all wrong, but prior to all that, he was from a very wealthy family. His father and uncle paid for new buildings for the Elliott School, where he was educated before going on to Harvard. He was a very able businessman, a very good politician and administrator. He worked personally with Ben Franklin, who was close to his age. They were a little older than the other revolutionaries. On the Albany Plan of Union, the start of the French and Indian War, an early attempt to get the colonies to unite. Didn't work out then. And of course, when the Troubles started, when the Sons of Liberty were created, and the stamp tax was instituted, This house, you see pictured, the Hutchinson Mansion on Garden Court Street, was a target of the mob's fury in August of 1765, because Hutchinson's cousin, Andrew Oliver, had been named one of the stamp agents, and a few years later, two of his sons would be named tea agents in Boston. In any event, the house was nearly destroyed, and Hutchinson and his daughter were lucky to escape with their lives in the summer of 1765. He had to show up the next day. He had a lot of different jobs, not entirely unusual, including Lieutenant Governor and Chief Justice of the SJC at the same time. He had to show up in court the next day, basically in his pajamas. He was humiliated. Anyway, in any event, he was governor during the Tea Party and the final years before Paul Revere's famous ride in 1775. So obviously a very important figure in American history and North End history, but you will not find him mentioned in the Prado. I guess there is such a thing as being on the wrong side of history. This, by the way, is the North End in 1934, as the Prado was being completed, and Dallin was furiously trying to find a home for the statue of Paul Revere. And there are some things you may recognize. The Old North Church. I have to lean over now.
Get my bearings.
St. Stephen's is on the edge. So that's the area for the Prado. There's the Dome of St. Leonard's, and behind it to the left, the Nazaro Center, still a bathhouse, of course, at the time. There's the Cushman School, named for Charlotte Cushman, who was born on that site in the 1800s. She became probably the most famous actress in the English-speaking world by the mid-19th century, and set up a salon in Italy where she sponsored other female artists of the day, sculptors, writers, actresses. And unfortunately, she became ill and returned with her partner, Emma Stebbins, the sculptor, to the United States. And about the year 1870, this Cushman School was finished. And she was there to talk to the girls on its dedication. The first time the city of Boston named a school for a woman. She said it was one of the happiest nights of her life. The old Hancock School is behind it. Both of those schools were sold by the city to the Archdiocese, the Catholic Archdiocese, to make way for what we remember as the CC Center, the Columbus Center, the gymnasium for St. Anthony's School, which was raised recently to build 44 Prince. Old St. Mary's can be seen at the left, where the Custom Rita Housing Project is now. And St. John's School, before its pitched roof and its campanile were taken down during the Depression. And there's the back of Sacred Heart. The very new Tunnel Administration Building, the Summer Tunnel, had opened this year, and many houses were removed here and in East Boston to make way for the ramps and the traffic. Can you imagine the Summer Tunnel for nearly 30 years was a two-way, the only tunnel to East Boston? And I can go on, but just to show you that here, as the Prado is being created on the bicentennial of Paul Revere's birth and the tercentenary of the city, 300 years of Boston, the North End had undergone many changes, but so many of its people are so part of our history that they can't be forgotten. Even if you try to forget about Paul Revere, you can't do it. And the buildings like this one, of course, these landmarks are here also to remind us of our history. And so this neighborhood then, that was inherited by the Italian community in Boston, rebuilt and preserved by them, has come down to us today. And so, you know, it's obviously a very long history with ups and downs. The North End at one time was the most prosperous and pleasant part of Boston, and another was the most dangerous, run-down, dirty place in the city. And today is the place where everyone goes for dinner, where all the tourists stream by to see, I believe this church is the most heavily visited historic site in the city. And where the people who work in the towers in the financial district bring their out-of-town clients. It's just, it's part of the experience of Boston, and for the 10,000 or so people who still live here, it's a place like no other. And as David mentioned, I only moved away a couple of years ago, and poor me, I'm still complaining about it. It's a beautiful new house, but, you know, there's no place like North End. So, once again, I wanted to thank you all for your attention. I believe David is going to come up and say one or two closing remarks. But thanks again to Reverend Ayers for hosting us, for the Resident Association for organizing this, and for your attention at this late hour. Thank you.